For it was by this grace that a man, without any antecedent merit, was at the very commencement of his existence as man, so united in one person with the Word of God, that the very person who was the Son of Man was at the same time Son of God, and the very person who was Son of God was at the same time Son of Man. And in the adoption of his human nature into the divine, the grace itself became in a way so natural to the man as to leave no room for the entrance of sin. Wherefore this grace is signified by the Holy Spirit, for he, though in his own nature God, may also be called the gift of God. And to explain all this sufficiently, if indeed it could be done at all, would require a very lengthened discussion. Chapter 41. Begotten and conceived, then, without any indulgence of carnal lust, and therefore bringing with him no original sin, and by the grace of God joined and united in a wonderful and unspeakable way in one person with the Word, the only begotten of the Father, a Son by nature, not by grace, and therefore having no sin of his own. Nevertheless, on account of the likeness of sinful flesh in which he came, he was called sin, that he might be sacrificed to wash away sin. For under the old covenant, sacrifices for sin were called sins. And he, of whom all these sacrifices were types and shadows, was himself truly made sin. Hence the apostle, after saying, "We pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God," forthwith adds, "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." He does not say, as some incorrect copies read, "He who knew no sin did sin for us," as if Christ had himself sinned for our sakes, but he says, "Him who knew no sin," that is, Christ, God, to whom we are to be reconciled, "hath made to be sin for us," that is, hath made him a sacrifice for our sins, by which we might be reconciled to God. He then, being made sin, just as we are made righteousness, our righteousness being not our own, but God's, not in ourselves, but in him, he being made sin, not his own, but ours, not in himself, but in us, showed by the likeness of sinful flesh in which he was crucified, that though sin was not in him, yet that in a certain sense he died to sin, by dying in the flesh, which was the likeness of sin, and that although he himself had never lived the old life of sin, yet by his resurrection he typified our new life springing up out of the old death in sin. Chapter 42. And this is the meaning of the great sacrament of baptism, which is solemnized among us, that all who attain to this grace should die to sin, as he is said to have died to sin, because he died in the flesh, which is the likeness of sin, and rising from the font regenerate, as he arose alive from the grave, should begin a new life in the Spirit, whatever may be the age of the body. Chapter 43. For from the infant newly born to the old man bent with age, as there is none shut out from baptism, so there is none who in baptism does not die to sin. But infants die only to original sin. Those who are older die also to all the sins which their evil lives have added to the sin which they brought with them. Chapter 44. But even these latter are frequently said to die to sin, though undoubtedly they die not to one sin, but to all the numerous actual sins they have committed in thought, word, or deed. For the singular number is often put for the plural, as when the poet says, "They fill its belly with the armed soldier," though in the case here referred to, there were many soldiers concerned. And we read in our own scriptures, "Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpent from us." He does not say serpents, though the people were suffering from many, and so in other cases. When, on the other hand, the original sin is expressed in the plural number, as when we say that infants are baptized for the remission of sins, instead of saying for the remission of sin, this is the converse figure of speech by which the plural number is put in place of the singular. As in the Gospel it is said of the death of Herod, "For they are dead which sought the young child's life," instead of saying, "He is dead." And in Exodus, "They have made them," Moses says, "gods of gold," though they had made only one calf, of which they said, "These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." Here, too, putting the plural in place of the singular. Chapter 45. However, even in that one sin by which one man entered into the world, and so passed upon all men, and on account of which infants are baptized, a number of distinct sins may be observed, if it be analyzed, as it were, into its separate elements. For there is in it pride, because man chose to be under his own dominion, rather than under the dominion of God, and blasphemy, because he did not believe God, and murder, for he brought death upon himself, and spiritual fornication, for the purity of the human soul was corrupted by the seducing blandishments of the serpent, and theft, for man turned to his own use the food he had been forbidden to touch, and avarice, for he had a craving for more than should have been sufficient for him, and whatever other sin can be discovered on careful reflection to be involved in this one admitted sin. Chapter 46. And it is said, with much appearance of probability, that infants are involved in the guilt of the sins not only of the first pair, but of their own immediate parents. For that divine judgment, "I shall visit the iniquities of the fathers upon the children," certainly applies to them before they come under the new covenant by regeneration. And it was this new covenant that was prophesied of when it was said by Ezekiel that the son should not bear the iniquity of the fathers, and that it should no longer be a proverb in Israel, "The fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge." Here lies the necessity that each man should be born again, that he might be freed from the sin in which he was born. For the sins committed afterwards can be cured by penitence, as we see is the case after baptism. And therefore the new birth would not have been appointed only that the first birth was sinful, so sinful that even one who was legitimately born in wedlock says, "I was shapen in iniquities, and in sins did my mother conceive me." He did not say "in iniquity" or "in sin," though he might have said so correctly, but he preferred to say "iniquities and sins," because in that one sin which passed upon all men, and which was so great that human nature was by it made subject to inevitable death, many sins, as I showed above, may be discriminated. And further, because there are other sins of the immediate parents, which, though they have not the same effect in producing a change of nature, yet subject the children to guilt unless the divine grace and mercy interpose to rescue them. Chapter 47. But about the sins of the other progenitors who intervene between Adam and a man's own parents, a question may very well be raised. Whether everyone who is born is involved in all their accumulated evil acts, in all their multiplied original guilt, so that the later he is born, so much the worse is his condition, or whether God threatens to visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generations, because in his mercy he does not extend his wrath against the sins of the progenitors further than that, lest those who do not obtain the grace of regeneration might be crushed down under too heavy a burden if they were compelled to bear as original guilt all the sins of all their progenitors from the very beginning of the human race, and to pay the penalty due to them, or whether any other solution of this great question may or may not be found in Scripture by a more diligent search and a more careful interpretation, I dare not rashly affirm. Chapter 48. Nevertheless, that one sin, admitted into a place where such perfect happiness reigned, was of so heinous a character that in one man the whole human race was originally, and, as one may say, radically condemned. And it cannot be pardoned and blotted out except through the one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who only has had power to be so born as not to need a second birth. Chapter 49. Now those who were baptized in the baptism of John, by whom Christ was himself baptized, were not regenerated, but they were prepared through the ministry of his forerunner, who cried, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord," for him in whom only they could be regenerated. For his baptism is not with water only, as was that of John, but with the Holy Ghost also, so that whoever believes in Christ is regenerated by that Spirit, of whom Christ, being regenerated, he did not need regeneration. Whence that announcement of the Father, which was heard after his baptism, "This day have I begotten thee," referred not to that one day of time on which he was baptized, but to the one day of an unchangeable eternity, so as to show that this man was one in person with the only begotten. For when a day neither begins with the close of yesterday, nor ends with the beginning of tomorrow, it is an eternal today. Therefore he asked to be baptized in water by John, not that any iniquity of his might be washed away, but that he might manifest the depth of his humility. For baptism found in him nothing to wash away, as death found in him nothing to punish. So that it was in the strictest justice, and not by the mere violence of power, that the devil was crushed and conquered. For, as he had most unjustly put Christ to death, though there was no sin in him to deserve death, It was most just that through Christ he should lose his hold of those who by sin were justly subject to the bondage in which he held them. Both of these, then, that is, both baptism and death, were submitted to by him, not through a pitiable necessity, but of his own free pity for us, and as part of an arrangement by which, as one man brought sin into the world, that is, upon the whole human race, so one man was to take away the sin of the world. Chapter 50. With this difference, the first man brought one sin into the world, but this man took away not only that one sin, but all that he found added to it. Hence the Apostle says, "And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification."